Thank you. My name is Amy Rader Olsen. I work with urban planning and institutional issues here at KTH. But today I'm actually here to talk to you about another of the hats that I wear, and that is as a coordinator for a relatively new initiative here within the School of Architecture and the Built Environment. And we call it the Urban Cluster, for lack of a better term, and I'll explain a little bit what it is. And I thought I'd give you a few examples of the kinds of projects, energy-related projects, that have to do with sustainable cities. So, why an urban cluster? When you work with cities, as many, I'm sure many people in this room actually do, you actually almost have to have a multidisciplinary approach all the time. I remember discussing with someone, what's a city? And how is a city different from, for example, a rural environment? And their definition, I thought, was rather interesting. It said that a city is where, in any human environment, in any biological environment, in any ecosystem, you have a lot of interests, actors, resources interacting in important ways, sometimes in harmony and sometimes in conflict. In an urban environment where you have dense agglomerations, all of these interactions are sort of speeded up. And we're all crashing into each other, but also working together in more intensive ways. And that means that the opportunities for cities to be centers for innovation are intensified, but it also means that the challenges are also there. So, in fact, what I'm working with, what we call the urban cluster, is really just sort of a way to try to formalize a lot of the work that we do all the time individually. But we thought that there might be a good reason for trying to create an urban center. One of the reasons is this last one here, that if you start calling yourself a center, you can then call up other centers and say, we're a center, and you're also a center. Let's do a project together. But some of the other reasons that we decided to do this are that people find within KTH, within our own school, and also with our partners in other universities, in the cities, and in public agencies and in business, that it's quite difficult to navigate the research into urban studies at KTH. It's happening all over the place. It's happening in different sectors. And we don't necessarily do a very good job of keeping each other abreast of what we're doing. So we're often sort of missing this common platform. We also find that we're spending an awful lot of time when we're trying to get together a multidisciplinary proposal. We're sort of reinventing the wheel all the time. So if we had ways to grease that wheel and navigate this sort of sea of exciting research, then we might all benefit. But that means that, in fact, what we do is not, we don't produce almost anything. What we try to do is leverage resources that we find throughout KTH and in other environments. And you've heard Professor Birgersson talk a little bit about these strategic platforms. These are a really important partner for us. We have had some common projects with the transportation platform and are happy to be here with the energy platform today. Because this is where we see the real Spetskompetenz, the real cutting edge sectoral research that we need to incorporate into our own urban research. There is another cluster within the School of Architecture in Built Environment that I just want to mention because it works very specifically with energy issues. And this cluster is interested in the way design, architectural design, can work more closely with designing things like energy systems and infrastructure. We also, of course, we work with ABE centers. You heard Anna Kromers talk about her work in the Center for Sustainable Communication. We have centers for banking and finance, etc. And, of course, we also try to work with individual initiatives and projects. So we're trying to help sort of navigate these waters and fill the gaps that they can't fill. So our guiding principles, you know, this is a slide I had from before, but it talks about energy. But in our world, a lot of the wasted energy isn't necessarily just transmission lines and fuel cells, but it's more to do with the energy that it takes us all to try to just figure out what's going on all the time. We don't, as I say, we're lean. We don't produce projects. What we try to do is leverage existing resources, and we try to grease the squeaky wheels. So if you raise your hand, if you give me a call and say you have an idea, I'll be more than happy to try to help connect you with others that you might be able to work together with. So think of me as sort of a broker. And that's true for all of you sitting here. You don't have to be within the School of Architecture and Built Environment to use us as a resource. In fact, we're thrilled to connect in a better way with the KTH community. Here are examples of some of the activities that we've done over the past year. We do try to work directly with getting projects off the ground, multidisciplinary proposals. And here again, please, we're more than happy to help you. If, for example, if you're working in materials science and you'd like to get in touch with somebody who knows something about architecture or urban planning, we're happy to put you in contact with the right people. We have something called a Plus One program, which is also something that might be of interest to many of you. We have a little bit of resources and a little bit of time to help make use of all these wonderful opportunities we have when all of these world-class researchers come to be opponents of dissertations, for example. If we can ask them to stay one more night in Stockholm and ask them to give an extra lecture to the KTH community, we often find that they're more than happy to stay. So we'll fund an extra hotel night, or we'll give you all some coffee or a glass of wine. So again, if you have people coming in that context, my criteria there is that it needs to be open to the KTH community, and it needs to be a fairly broad, cross-disciplinary and urban focus. We do keep in contact with other urban clusters. We work with some of the areas in which KTH has strategic partnerships. For example, we're developing strategic partnerships with the University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign, and some of the other areas in which KTH centrally has developed some contacts. We go around to conferences and get involved in networks and give speeches. We try to have things like case study clubs, where maybe everybody who's working in the Royal Seaport project, an important energy project, can all get together and talk about what they're doing. We're also trying to get a book off the ground. And here again, mostly what we do is try to help people navigate. We act as sort of brokers for information and for people. So here's some examples of how we can help. More specifically, if you want to get a project off the ground and you're looking for partners, that can be partners within the ABE school. It can also be partners if you're looking for a partner in Tanzania, or you're looking for a partner at another university. We'll do what we can to help. We'd like to think that we serve the entire KTH community. We do help to get multidisciplinary proposals started. So when some of these big funding opportunities from Minova or from Portimas or from Mistra come, we tend to try to get the word out, and we tend to try to organize meetings and, again, buy each other a cup of coffee and talk about how we can get things started. We try to flag new opportunities where we think that there are similar interests. There might be a similar interest in a systems approach, for example, but we have people working in biotech and people working in urban studies. Perhaps we can find each other in terms of similar methodologies and ways of thinking. We do help, we're starting to help arrange visits and talk in terms of courses. We have a lot of people that tell us that multidisciplinary courses are something that students are starting to demand, but that we're not necessarily very well rigged to supply. And we do what we can there. Here are a few examples of the types of way in which energy comes into urban sustainability issues. You've heard about some of these already. Because we use space and geography as sort of our unit of analysis rather than a specific sector, energy tends to come in as we talk about energy in society, energy in our cities. But as you see, you know, the range could go sometimes to the infrastructure issues, such as how do you get smart grids, what's the best way to implement smart grids, but it might also have to do with things like energy justice. You heard some examples from Africa about how uneven the distribution of accessibility is to energy. And in fact, we find in many developing country contexts that the poor are paying more for energy, for water, for education, than their richer counterparts because of the way we provide public services. We also are interested in these areas of persuasive technologies, where in fact we are interested in the ways in which our behavior is conditioned by the feedback signals that we get from our built environment. And one of the big hot button issues that I can definitely see coming around the bend, and if you're interested in this area, please let me know. We have a lot of people that want to work with KTH on the issue of renovating those 650,000 units of public housing that need to be renovated, and which many of which have very poor energy performance. I thought I would spend just a few more minutes racing through a couple of kind of interesting examples of projects. These are not cluster projects. As I said, we do not produce projects, but we do spend a lot of time trying to talk about projects that we think do a good job of bringing lots of different perspectives in urban issues together. And we're happy to take credit for them. So here are some. I actually have some representatives for these projects sitting here today if you have more specific questions. The first one I'll just mention, I won't have the time to go through all of these, but these kind of represent our goals as a cluster, so that's why I've chosen them today. One of the things, as I said, we try to foster in research as well as practice is tools and methods for getting these different sectors together and for getting different types of actors that institutionally might be fragmented working together. I have another project that is more focused on actual practical tools for getting university research together with what's going on with practitioners, which you've also heard a little bit about this morning. Another project has to do with shared learning and shared learning across countries. This is more of a best practice type of initiative where we're working together with Italy. And finally, something I want to emphasize here, when you work with cities, you're working with a combination of new technologies and new innovations and new people in new cities, but also a fairly large capital stock of housing, of transportation infrastructure, of energy infrastructure, et cetera. So we try to focus in particular on innovations that incorporate both new technologies and also make better use of existing technologies. And I think I'll just take about 2 minutes and go through these in a real broad brush way. And again, if you have specific questions, we'll go through those. So here's an example of how we try to work across sectors. This is actually sponsored by the Swedish Energy Agency and involves a large number of municipalities with the idea that thinking about renewable energy is a way of thinking about a whole lot of other things. So we have been working with the urban planning aspect of this, and the idea is that we're trying to develop methods partly based in the architectural traditions such as the charrette, where we take real-world problems and we all sit around and put people in a room and throw in a little bit of meat every once in a while and tell them to solve it. This is what it looks like in real life. So we're looking at very specific case studies, and we're looking at capacity building and building common perspectives. Here's a somewhat different kind of a project. This is focusing on trying to develop sort of user-friendly tools for practitioners to start thinking about all this complexity that we find in cities, and also to help scientists and practitioners work more closely together. So this has to do with, again, with these retrofit policies for energy-consuming areas and trying to understand what types of technologies make the most sense and where. So here, again, because we're urban, we have to think a lot about the way that the system interacts in a larger perspective, not just at the building scale. Here's another one. This is, as I said, this is across countries, not counties, although we're happy to share across counties. This is an initiative where Sweden is working together with Italy, and where, again, we're using the urban, what we call urban cells, which are still in the process of being defined, the kind of the unit of analysis that help us understand sometimes what we call the metabolism, the inflows and the outflows of energy and what makes the most sense for different areas of the city. And here's some more about that. Finally, here's a brand new project that just was awarded funding through the Vinnova Innovations Call that was just came out. This is a really good example where we have district heating systems that a lot of municipalities have a lot of large investments. And a lot of them aren't making very much money anymore. And this is a way where we could perhaps use the advantages of new types of housing and building technologies that allow us to use a lower temperature to try to make more out of the resources we have, and ultimately to try to make some of these capital infrastructure serve us into the future. So please do contact us if we can help out at all. I've left some flyers also out in the lobby explaining a little bit more about the cluster. So don't hesitate. Thank you.